There's a saying that you don't know a man until you've worked with him. My dad and I worked a lot together. I grew up cutting firewood. I was actually sharing with my wife. She was asking me some questions about growing up on the farm. Dad and I spent a lot of time on a hay wagon together. There was one summer in particular where my dad got this idea that we're going to become hay farmers. Hay had gone up in price, and so that one summer, I'm guessing I handled some 10,000 bales of hay. I was a lot stronger and more fit back then. But and I really prided myself in that. But when you spend that kind of quality time with someone, when you're in day in and day out, you really get to know them and you get to appreciate them. And that's probably the greatest gift my dad ever gave me, is he taught me the value of hard work. Today we're starting a new series on the book of John. And as I've contemplated this, and I've contemplated the time that John, the author, spent with Jesus, I think some of what we will see in this is that interaction of this is someone he spent time with, probably worked some with and alongside, and so we'll see that interaction. The book of John is one of the most recommended books in the Bible. Many times, if there's a new believer or someone who wants to get to know who this Jesus is, I recommend the book of John. I know speaking with you, many of you were told that in your early days of faith. Hey, read the book of John. It's a good recommendation. It's also a good recommendation if your faith has grown old. Or if it's stagnant, it's a good one to renew and deepen your faith. It's honestly one of my favorite books to study and teach from. Honestly, because I get lost in Christ. As I read the book of John and his personal encounter with Jesus, I get lost in who Jesus is. It's got a beautiful simplicity and a depth at the same time. John has this ability to take these complex truths about Jesus and insert them into the personal encounters where we really get to know him. It's been said that John is shallow enough on the edges that a child can play in it, but deep enough in the middle that you could sink a ship in. And so as we start to look at this, I think it's important that that we look at the purpose of the book. John spells it out for us in John chapter 20, why he wrote this book. And so I think it's good that we would look at that. Now, to give you an idea, we will be in the book of John until the first week in October. So if you don't like it, well, we're going to be here for a minute. And so hence why we are changing some of our decor. We're going to talk about John and his history as a fisherman. And so we've gone with a little bit of a nautical theme up here. In John 20, verses 30 to 31, John tells us the purpose of his book. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. And so John tells us pretty clearly from the beginning that he wrote this so that you may believe in Jesus and that you may find the life that John found in the name of Jesus. Now, to get our mind around the book of John, it is 21 chapters. So our pace, some weeks we will cover a chapter, some weeks we will not. And there's a lot there. There's 21 chapters to cover. And I was thinking about this idea, how do we cover that much? It's about 15,000 words. And so another pastor that I looked up had calculated that out. If you like Twitter, that's 521 tweets. Now picture this, trying to tweet 521 tweets and capture the life and the journey of 3.5 years with the Son of God. To give you an idea, the average person on Twitter has approximately 600 tweets. On their account, during the Super Bowl, 30 million nearly tweets on a football game. And so John has boiled so much of Jesus' life, so much could be said. If we can spend 30 million tweets on a football game, imagine what we could glean out of the life of Christ. And you know, it kind of leaves me with the question, if I were tasked with this, if I had been in John's shoes, could I have captured the breadth and depth of 3.5 years with the Son of God? I don't think I could have. And so that leaves us with the question of who is John, who authored the book? Now, I read some really screwball theories out there. I heard a sermon about how it was John the Baptist. That doesn't make sense since he dies early in the book of John. That was a bit of a misled person. I've heard that it was Lazarus. One of my commentaries, which that makes a little sense, because how did Lazarus know what Jesus shouted outside of his tomb when he was dead? And also I've heard that it was Thomas. But most scholars agree that it was John, one of the 12 disciples. And most scholars agree that John was very young, possibly the youngest of the disciples when he joined Jesus. Now, most scholars agree that the disciples were all teenagers. Now, I want you to get your mind around this as we look at this. I used to be a youth pastor, okay? And if I was going to change the world, would I take 12 teenagers and invest my life and entrust them with the gospel of good news? Would you? I think I would. Jesus did. He entrusted it to the 12 disciples. He entrusted everything to them. And so John, according to the scholars, most of them that I've read, is the author, one of the disciples, who also wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and this book that we've studied a lot in our church lately, Revelation. John lived out his life. He was the only one of the 12 disciples that, according to church history, did not die young. And so he lived out his life. We see John first appear in the other Gospels. Now, he doesn't name himself in his Gospel. He calls himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. We see John appear in a couple places. Mark 3:17 references James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James. And in Luke 5:9, we see this picture of John where it says, "For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish." So this is after the miraculous catch of fish. "And also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon." And so actually they were partners, which is interesting, because if you walk through the gospel, you see this kind of a playful getting at each other sometimes between John and Peter, and they were partners, so it makes sense. "And Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid, from now on you'll be catching men.' And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him." John was a fisherman, his father and brother, and he was partnered with Peter. Now, John never discloses himself. Many times throughout his books, such as John 13:23, he simply refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Now, a quick note about this. When I first read this, I always thought, well, so John was a teacher's pet. Right? How many of you were that in school? Be honest. No one? That was me. I'll admit it. But it was. So I used to think that. Why did he think he was better than the other disciples? Jesus loved him more. And the conclusion I came to actually after hearing a sermon on John 21 from Reverend Stumbo, the president of the U.S. Alliance, is this. John said this because his life was defined by one thing. Jesus' love. Do you get that? His life was wrapped up in one thing. Jesus loves me and my relationship with him. I said John wrote this book near the end of his life, according to scholars. And so this would have been after seeing or hearing about most of the disciples, all of his friends being killed or even tortured for the name of Christ. Yet after all that, he pens this beautiful picture of the love of Christ. And hence the title for this series, The Gospel of John, A Portrait of Love. Because this is John's heart. He is writing about this love relationship with Jesus Christ. Now I was thinking about that and what that was like for him, the journey. And it actually also reminded me not only of working with someone. I've mentioned before, Wendy and I love to hike. That's both of us individually, separately. It's one of our favorite things to do. And so we've been various places hiking. We went our honeymoon. We hiked up a mountain in the Smokies. We were sweaty, nasty, grimy. But we had a great time because we were out in nature hiking. There's a place we would love to go again sometime. This is in Hocking Hills, Ohio. It's a beautiful place if you've never been there. So we used to like to go out and hike. But one time I got the chance through the Alliance, I had to go to a training in Colorado Springs. And so I went out by myself. I went out to the Garden of the Gods in Pikes Peak. I know some of you have been there. And I found something, though, in those places as I went out to hike and enjoy nature, I found it strangely empty because Wendy wasn't there. And so I get this picture. What John is describing is this beautiful thing that this life, even though he had seen, you know, his friends die or heard of them dying for their faith, he had known persecution, he'd known an exile on an island. It doesn't matter because it's with Christ. The journey is with Jesus. And that's I think that's the essence of what he's getting at here. It's all about this love relationship. And I see it because I love to hike a lot, but it's really not the same without Wendy. And now as our family grows and gets older, it's fun with Wendy and the kids because it's cute to see them react to all the different stuff. And so we start the book of John. Now this first section that we're going to look at today, verses 1 through 18, is a bit poetic. Many believe that it may have been some sort of a hymn or something that John added later. He may have penned the gospel originally and then went back and added verses 1 through 18 as kind of an intro into the book and to carry some of the themes of it. And so we see in John 1 through 18, it's a bit poetic and it seems to have kind of four stanzas or sections. So we're going to look at these one section at a time. The first one, verses 1 through 2 in John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Now this word here, in the beginning was the Word. The word used for word here is logos, where we get the word logo from. It means the message or words or even the teaching. And John is saying here right off the bat that the message, the words, the teaching of God is not just words, but a person. All of Jesus' life speaks to you and me. When we talk about logos, it could encapsulate the reason or thought within a person and the expression of that thought in speech. And so when we talk about word, this wasn't a far-fetched thing for it to be something tangible. In the Old Testament, God's Word was active, it was powerful, and it was something that was alive. And so John is starting off right out here, and he is saying Jesus is the final decisive Word. Doesn't get any better than that. Jesus was and is God, and as the Word, Jesus is the fulfillment of all of God's promises. In 1:1, we see this echo of the Trinity as well as it talks about Jesus was with God and was God. And so we see this is one of those passages that we use to talk about that God is three in one. That He is one, but He exists eternally in three persons. So the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So Jesus has always been there, He always will be, and He always has been and always will be God. John's saying that not only was Jesus the Messiah and the greatest of all people, but He is the I Am that has existed forever. He is God. The second stanza moves into some discussion about Jesus and the creation. It says, through Him, all things were made. Without Him, nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John, the other John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through Him all men might believe. He Himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. John is saying right here that all things, not only was Jesus there in the beginning, but all things were created by Him and for Him. And so I want to remind you of what Thomas George said when he was here, our district superintendent. You were created by God, and you were created for God. We also see in this section the beginning of this play of darkness versus light. It's a theme throughout the Gospel of John. And I think it's a good picture of the good versus evil. And he sees these two forces as opposing to each other and in conflict at all times. Now, it's interesting because darkness really is not a thing, right? It's just simply the absence of light. But sometimes we still like the darkness. This morning, on Sunday mornings, I usually get up really early. I'm first one here. You have to be here really early to beat Dan Swoveland because he's here making coffee. But I beat him most of the time. I'm here quite early. You know the harshest moment in the morning? You know, first of all, we're still in a hotel, so my normal pattern, you know, of getting up and I can half blindly walk to the bathroom doesn't work. If I do that, I run smack into the TV in the hotel room. Not the same path. But it's that moment where I get to the bathroom, right, and I got to flip that switch. And you know how that is. You all been there. I mean, it's just super bright. We don't like it. It's intense. And sometimes we just don't like the light. John speaks to this in John 3. In verse 19, he says, "The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works are evil." So as we start into the book of John, we need to start with this preface and understanding that our natural tendency is to shy away from the light. No matter how long you've been a Christian, the sin nature in you will always want to pull you out of the light of God. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. John is saying here that even when the cure was available, we still drink the poison. The world is slave to its own sin, and it likes it. Humanity likes our filthy mess in the darkness. It's like what John is saying, we're in this dark jail cell and that's the only thing we've ever known, and we think we're so free and we like this, and we don't want the guy outside the door to open it because the light will come in. And that is what we see a picture here. No one is exempt from this dilemma. Even God's chosen people, as John will say later, were not exempt from this. They don't like the light. Now, he references John the Baptist here. The reference is basically because there was this kind of heresy going along for a while that people thought John the Baptist was the light, that he was the Messiah. And people would ask him that, "Are you the one? Are you the chosen one?" And he's refuting that. He's saying John is not the light, but simply a witness to it. And it's such a beautiful testimony because even in the darkest corners of this life, God is always sending people ahead to point people back to the light. I pray that we are one of those people going forward, a body going forward, pointing others to the light. The third stanza starts talking about the Word in Revelation. So moving on in verse 9. "The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was not made through him, And though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God." Now, this term for world here, it has many connotations to it. It's quite fascinating. It actually, some of the connotations it carries is like an ornament, like we think on a Christmas tree or something we hang up for beauty. God created this world to be this lovely and ordered ornament, this beautiful thing for him to look at. And instead, it turned away from him and become this ugly, strife-torn chaos because men rejected God. However, God loves the world and he intends to redeem it by rescuing it from rescuing helpless people from the world itself. So dark and light are at war. And John makes it really clear. There is no in-between. To reject Christ or any part of who he is to choose darkness. Period. Now, as I studied this week, I got lost on a rabbit trail, and I'm going to take you with me on my rabbit trail. And I started studying this idea of dark and light in Scripture. And there's quite a few references in Scripture as we go along. Psalm 36, 9 says this, "For with you is a fountain of light, of life, in your light we do see." And so there's idea in Scripture that life and light are associated with each other, and that without it we are just lost, we cannot see. Psalm 119, an excellent psalm on the Word, says, "Your Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." We know that Scripture well. So when we talk about light, that the Word and light is this illumination so we can see where we're going. Psalm 119, 130, "The unfolding of your words gives light and imparts understanding to the simple." So when John is referencing light, he's talking about the understanding of the Almighty, the understanding of the divine. In contrast, when we talk about darkness, Proverbs 4:19 says that the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble. And that's what it's like to walk without Christ. We don't know over what we stumble. We see that in our world around us, don't we? All these things and just the political landscape, so many people they're just tripping over everything because they are stumbling around in the darkness. Isaiah 60, verse 1 and 2 says, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." So light here is associated with the glory of the Lord. It says, "For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise among you, and His glory will be seen upon you." And so this idea of light is associated with the glory of God. We already mentioned John 3:19, where it says that the people did not like the light because it exposes them. So the light has this exposing thing where we are laid bare before the God of the universe. And finally, Ephesians 5 talks about so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. And so we see that darkness is associated with the power of Satan, whereas light is associated with the power of God. And they may receive forgiveness of sins and place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. For one time you were in darkness, but now you're light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of things they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Awake, O sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you." So when John is saying that Jesus is the light, what John is saying is Jesus is the life. Jesus is the lamp unto my feet. He is saying that Jesus is the understanding and Jesus is the full glory of God. He's saying that Jesus, as He comes, He exposes you, exposes every part of you in the sin for what it is. But at the same time as you are exposed and you are completely vulnerable, He wraps His righteousness around you and offers forgiveness. Jesus is everything that is good, everything that is right, and everything that is true. And this is the Jesus that John describes. It tells us in this section, "Yet to all who received Him, to those who believed in His name, He gave the right to become the children of God." Now, you need to understand something. When we talk about this receiving Him, in the ancient world, someone's name represented the essence of their character. So to believe on the name of the Word is not just about believing what He says, but it's about believing in Him, that He is true and trustworthy. In ancient Greek accounting, on the name literally means like in possession of. So believing is yielding ourselves to be owned by God. Now that's not a popular term in today's culture. If you want to yield yourself to God, you have to be a slave to Him and owned. You are not your own. You are property of the Most High. And that's what John is describing. John Piper, I think, says it well. talking about receiving him. He says receiving Jesus means taking Jesus into your life for what he is. It does not mean a peaceful kind of coexistence with a Christ who makes no claims, as though he can stay in the house as long as he doesn't play his music so loud. Receiving Jesus means taking him into your life, your home, your school, your work, your marriage, your dreams for who he really is. So John is describing this picture as if you take Jesus for all he is, all that John is describing and all that he will describe, you have the right to become children of God. But no less is required. You have to give it all to him. You have to receive all of him. Too often Christians, they walk around with this pseudo-Christian faith where they carry the title and you know they talk about what church they go to, but they don't live it out. That's walking in darkness, according to John, and you are not children of God. You have to receive all of him. I think a good illustration is from marriage, and I'm taking this from another preacher, but it's so true. Do you know that most men, when they get married, they marry a woman for how she is right at that moment? Do I get an amen from the men? Yeah, right? Yeah, she's gorgeous, she's sweet. Women, many times, marry men for the thing they think they will become. Right? They look at him and, you know what? I can work with this. I can do something about it. Women, you know it's true. And the problem is this. Women change. Right? That's the joke, right? They're allowed to change your mind about anything. And, you know, through time, they change their hobbies and their interests. And you know, all of us, our bodies get older. And so men start to struggle with that. And as women try to change their men, guess what? Men don't change. I hope I am a far more mature man than I was when I first married my wife. Hopefully she'll attest to that. But some of the silly things that I'm interested in, I've been interested in since I was like 12. When we go up to the men's retreat and we shoot off Tannerite, which is an explosive round you shoot, and we make things go boom, I've liked watching things go boom since I was 12, okay? We don't change. And so the problem in marriage is, so we get this in marriage counseling, right? That I've seen it personally where, you know, they come in and the woman's upset because, you know what, I thought he could have been this and he's not. Well, that was a bad idea to think you could change him. And the same thing with the men, you know, I thought my wife would always look exactly like she did when she was 21. Well, I hate to tell you, you don't look like you did when you were 21. None of us do, unless you're still there. We need to embrace reality in our marriages, first of all, that we are who we are. We need to accept our spouse for who they are. And John is saying to embrace the reality that Jesus is who he is. Jesus comes to you and he demands that he is your Lord. And he will accept nothing less. The fourth stanza, the final section of this, in 14 through 18, tells us this. And it kind of ties back to the beginning. The beginning said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This is he of whom I said, he who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me. From the fullness of his grace, we have all received grace upon grace." Now, if you've been a believer for a while, can I hear an amen to that? Grace upon grace. That is such a picture of our faith. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known. Jesus is God stepping into our context. He is essentially the author becoming a page in the book. When it says that he made his dwelling, it literally means to pitch one's tent or to tabernacle. Jesus tabernacled among us. And John is tying this allusion back to when the Israelites were wandering around in the desert and God's glowing cloud, His presence was visibly seen in the tabernacle and around the tabernacle. John is boldly identifying Jesus as the Word with God's visible presence. He's identifying Jesus with the manifested acts of power of God. But he's saying now the manifestation is not a fiery cloud. It's the crude physical humanness of a man. Now it's interesting when we talk about the glory of the Lord, that's become a bit of an abstract thought for us now. It's this thing we talk about. We know God has glory, but we talk about it. In the Old Testament, God's glory was visible. It was a visible manifestation of His majesty and acts of power. When they looked at this pillar of fire, they saw God's glory. It was tangible to them. And so John is saying that Jesus is now the new tangible power and presence of God. And it tells us that He came full of grace and truth. Now, grace and truth are those two concepts that we tend to see that they are in opposition to one another. And honestly, as humans, we tend to be one or the other. And so, if you're all grace, and there's people like this, it's like trying to drive in a nail with a wet pool noodle. Does it work? The limp noodle's not going to do anything. But there are other people who are all truth, and it's like they're doing construction with a wrecking ball. And we see these things in opposition, and Jesus was perfectly both together. Grace and truth are not opposed. So the question before us is, was Jesus grace or truth? And the answer is yes, He was both. Jesus exemplified both. When it says this, receiving grace upon grace, it's this picture John is giving this of just being overwhelmed with blessing after blessing after blessing in Christ. Grace after grace after grace, that I follow Him, I rest in His truth, that when I falter, I have this grace and I can come running back. Now this grace is piled up on top of tough truths. It is. But John is giving us a theology of hope in the only solid place we can put it, God's own intervention in the world. John is saying that God has taken the initiative and new possibilities are now open to men. Divine power invaded our broken world and now we can be transformed. God entered the world in grace and truth to free it. Now when we talk about grace, I want us to understand this is not merely an attribute of God. It is an attribute. But grace is known when someone enjoys God's goodness. It's the recipient who knows grace, not the theologian who has studied it. So to receive Jesus is about enjoying God's goodness in my life. That as I make Him Lord and I give myself over and I'm not my own, that I discover in the midst of it life in the goodness of God. And we talk about truth. Truth is not just about right and wrong. Truth in God's eyes is about what is divine, what is like God, and that makes it right and true. Now it's interesting, John actually refers to the law here, recognizing that there are Jewish audience. But really the law was just an earlier form of God's grace. Do you understand that? There was lots of rules. But it was an act of grace because God gave His people a picture. This is what living within the line of my character looks like. It was an act of grace so that they would not be at odds with God. John ends by saying that no one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only who's at the Father's side, has made Him known. And he is basically saying this: Christ is fully God, and therefore He is the pinnacle of revelation of God to men. So the question as we end this section, I want to always come back to the now what. I mean, this is all good. I have four things for you. First and foremost, I don't know everyone in this room. I have to ask, have you accepted Jesus, all of who He is, and allowed Him to step into your life? And if you have, is it a peaceful coexistence where he's allowed to stay if he keeps the music down, or is he Lord of the house? There is a difference. The second question I would ask is, are there areas in your life where the light has been absent? Are there rooms inside your heart that you have kept locked up because you know the light hurts? And if that is you, give him the key. Thirdly, are you following Jesus' model in exercising grace and truth? Or are you all grace and you're trying to drive nails with a wet pool noodle? Or are you all truth and trying to do construction with a wrecking ball? All grace, you'll never get anything done. And all truth, you'll tear down more than you build up. Are you exercising Jesus' model of grace and truth? And lastly, I think the most important thing, even if you've been a believer for 50 years, I have to ask, as you see this description of John, of Jesus, and as we walk through this, is Jesus as precious to you as he was to John? Does Jesus' love for you the defining thing in your life? When someone asks about you and what you're passionate about and what you love and what makes you, the first thing that should be coming out of your mind and out of your mouth is your relationship with Christ. That my life is defined as a child of God and that I am beloved. That is the first thing. Not an engineer or a pastor or a worker at McDonald's. You are first and foremost a child of the King and our loved. Is that you this morning? Let's pray. And as we pray, I'm actually going to pray and paraphrase Paul's prayer in Ephesians 3, because I think this is relevant. Heavenly Father, for this reason, I bow my knees before you, the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of your glory, you might grant us to be strengthened with power through your Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And Lord, I do pray that us as a church, that as we are rooted and grounded in love, that you will give us strength to comprehend what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses all understanding, that you may be filled with all the fullness, that we may be filled with all the fullness of you. Father, may it be so. Would you grant this to us? Grant us the strength to know the depth of your love, so that as we wade into the book of John, that we eventually find ourselves lost in your love and in the person and character of Christ. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.